God bless you, loved ones. Welcome to the Word with Chester. Today we'll be starting our study in the 28th chapter of the Gospel of St. Matthew. This will be the last chapter in this book, and I am so grateful God has blessed us to go completely through the first book of the New Testament, the book of St. Matthew. As we start our reading today, we'll begin at verse 1. But just to give you a preface to as to what was had just transpired, we find that they had took counsel and they decided to put a watch on the sepulcher, on the tomb where Jesus was laid, because the Pharisees, the religious leaders of that day, thought that the disciples would come and steal the body away and say that there was a resurrection. And so they went to the hierarchy and asked them to put a watch there so that this wouldn't happen. Because in their mind, if that would happen, the state of the situation would actually be worse than it was at first. So they asked for this watch. And Pilate said unto them, "Ye have your watch, go your way, make it secure as ye can." So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone, and setting the watch. In so many words, they had somebody sitting there, as you would place a guard, watching the tomb. As we start reading in verse 1 of chapter 28, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. I would take time to explain the Sabbath and things of that nature, and when it is, the exact day it is. But I want you to know that this was going toward the end of the Sabbath, the Bible says, but starting on the first day of the week. And we know that the Christian worship on Sunday, this is actually a memorial of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and not the actual Sabbath day. And I can explain that further as time goes on. Possibly I'll spend almost a full session as we go into another gospel. Again, let me read verse 1. At the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for lo, an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. So what actually happened? The keepers, the ones that were watching, they began to tremble and they fainted right there because of what they saw. They began to fear and fainted. As we read verse 5, and the angels answered and said unto the women, "Fear not, for I know that ye seek Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay." So the angel talked to the women and let them know what had transpired, and let them know that the Lord was risen from the dead. I could go into some sayings on that, but I choose to move on here. This is such an important passage of scripture, and anyone that would doubt the resurrection, it's impossible for you to be a Christian. Why? Because this is another key part of evidence letting us know that this was Jesus the Christ. If you don't believe in the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, then you cannot be a Christian, because this is one of the key fundamental areas of scripture that the Christian religion is firmly founded on. So the angels came and talked to them, the innkeepers. They actually fainted like dead men, and the angel talked to the women and let them know he's not here. He's risen, as he said, just like he said he would. Then the angel invited them and said, "Come see the place where the Lord lay." As we read verse 7, "And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you unto Galilee. there shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. So he commissioned the women, let them know to go talk to the disciples. Go and tell the disciples he goeth to Galilee. There he shall see them, and the women did as they were instructed by him. And they departed quickly from the sepulcher, and feared, and great joy did run to bring his disciples word. They ran quickly to where the disciples were to give them this good news that the Lord had risen from the dead. You have to understand that Jesus had told his disciples what was going to transpire. He had told them that he was going to raise from the dead. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them saying, all hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. So Jesus met them on their way as they were going to talk to the disciples. In verse 10, then said Jesus unto them, be not afraid, go tell my brethren that I go unto Galilee, and there shall they see me. Well, Jesus talking to them and letting them know what they should do. Verse 11, now when they were going, behold, some of the watch came unto the city and showed unto the chief priests all the things that were done. You have to understand, those that stood by and who had set in position to be a watch over the sepulcher, because they didn't want it noised around that Jesus would raise from the dead. They didn't want any fluke thing to happen, like someone come away and steal away his body and then go tell the story that he had raised from the dead. But these same men that they sat there to watch, they came and told them. They came and told the chief priest everything that they saw. In so many words, they saw and they witnessed this angel. They witnessed all the things that had transpired. And when they were assembled with the elders and said and had taken counsel, they gave much money unto the soldiers. In other words, they paid them. They paid them all, saying, say ye, his disciples came by night and stole him away while he slept. In other words, this did not happen, but they paid him to say it. They paid him to lie about it. And you'd be surprised how many folks have fall prey to lie on something or to lie about something when money is involved. So they paid them to go and fabricate this story. And if this come to the governor's ears, we will persuade him and secure you. In so many words, if this gets out and you get in trouble about it, we're going to come and talk up for you so that you won't get in trouble. As we read verse 15, so they took the money and did as they were taught. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day. In so many words, this same story that they fabricated is talked about even until this day. Well, let's read verse 16. Verse 16 said, then the 11 disciples went away unto Galilee, unto a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke unto them, saying, now wait a minute now. You got to understand, these were the disciples. It talked about the 11. Remember, Judas had hung himself because he couldn't forgive himself. He repented of his wrongdoing because he betrayed our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. And then he went and hung himself. Now, so we're talking about the 11. As we read verse 17, and when they saw him, they worshipped him, and some doubted. Now, you got to understand, Jesus had told them that he was going to raise again on the third day. He had told them all the situation, what was going to transpire, and some still didn't believe it. Even those 11, some did not believe it. Some of them doubted. Well, they saw him with their eyes, but yet they doubted. And you got to understand, when somebody is dead, and you know they're clinically dead, graveyard dead, whatever you want to call it, and you see them again, it brings some type of skepticism upon the average person. Why? Because this person's supposed to be dead. We saw him with our eyes. We saw what they did to him. We saw how they crucified him. The Bible said here, and some doubted. Verse 18, and Jesus came and spoken to them, saying, all power, the King James Version said, the New King James Version said, all authority, all power, all authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world, the end of the age. Amen. We've read through this entire book now. Such an important passage of scripture. And I'm not going into doctrinal differences about baptismal formulas and things of that nature. You know, and I choose not to go into those areas, because I am not narrow-minded, and Jesus is not narrow-minded. Here he did make a statement. He made a statement in verse 19, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and in the name of the Son and in the name of the Holy Ghost. I can go into many areas and talk about formulas, baptismal formulas, and stipulate different things that Jesus has said in his word. But I'm going to tell you, when you go down in that water in his name, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost, every devil in hell knows who you're talking about. So Jesus, he's commanding us to be baptized, and I'm not going to argue formula, and I'm not going to argue what this church says or what that church says. I do say that you need, if you accept Jesus as your personal Savior, you need to do what he says and be baptized. Be baptized in water, and I guarantee you, you'll please him. When you accept his word, you'll please him. When you accept and do what he tells you to do. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the ends of the earth, ends of the age. Well, a key point here, you need to know that God is with you. You need to know that Jesus is with you always, not just for a short time. Don't get hung up on little doctrinal differences. Get the truth of the Bible and know that he's with you. Even in your darkest hour, know he's with you always. Know he's with you when you're at the pinnacle, when everything is going well in your life. Know that he's with you. He's with you always. He's not like some fair weather friends that are here today and gone tomorrow, or on your side when things are going well, but as soon as you hit a bump in the road and things are not going so well for you, you'll see who your friend are, who will walk away from you, and who won't be there for you, who will turn the tables and lie on you, or who will even tell the truth just to gain something out of it. But I want you to know Jesus is with you always. He promised he will never leave you or forsake you. That's what you need to drive in your spirit. That's what you need to get in your heart. Jesus will never leave you, regardless of the circumstances. My time is rapidly running out for this session. But know, my friend, I love you with the love of the Lord. If you need to contact me, you can contact me, 3741 Candle Bluff Drive, San Antonio, Texas, 78244. You can also reach me at my website, www.poemsbychester.com. Remember, I love you, my friends, with the love of the Lord. God bless you.